The first week we learned that the Holy Spirit's a person. He's not a mist. He's not some kind of mystical creature. But the Holy Spirit is a person. We learned that God, He's the Father. He's the creator of all. Jesus, He's the Son, and He's the Savior of all. And the Holy Spirit, He's the helper of all. Then last week we learned that the Holy Spirit has a job to do. So we learned what work He does. You know, we put Him through a job interview to see if He could handle this job that is running our life. Let me tell you, He does a pretty good job at it if you'll let Him. This week, I want to talk about my favorite part of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit. Come on, somebody. How many people could use a little bit of power from on high today? Come on. That's what I want to talk about today. So, my question for you is, how do I access the Holy Spirit's power? See, it's real nice to talk about this power, but unless you can access it and use it, then there's no use to even have it. So my question is, as I'm preaching today, I'm gonna kind of do this from a perspective of, like, doubt. I'm gonna do this from a perspective of, well, are you sure about this? You know what I mean? I'm gonna kind of use a non-believer's perspective of this, because when you talk about the Holy Spirit's power, a lot of people think, you know, this was something for the early church. This is something the first century church did. You know, the saints. This is something for the saints. This ain't something for us today. But what I want to show you is that the power of the Holy Spirit's available for you today. You don't have to be someone special. You don't have to be a pastor. You don't have to have a squeaky clean record. But let me tell you, the Holy Spirit's power is available for all of us. So if you'll listen to what I have to say today, and you'll take heart, the Holy Spirit can move in incredible ways through your life. So how do I access the power of the Holy Spirit? In Acts 1:5, Jesus says, John baptized with water, but in just a few days, you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Come on. So everybody knew about baptism. Everybody knew John. He was dunking folks in the lake. And everybody knew that this is something that you do as an outward sign to say, hey, I'm walking with Jesus now. So Jesus says, you know, John baptized with water, but in a few days, you're going to be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Why do I need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? Good question. Why do I need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? Acts 1:8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So you need to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit because you need God's power. This is how the early church got their power. You know, and this was it enabled people that were scared or they were timid. You know, most of his disciples, when Jesus was crucified, they ran away. So they had to wait for this power enabled to be a witness. Well, how did the apostles receive this power? Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. This is when the Holy Spirit comes. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm. It filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. Can you imagine this? This is 50 days after Jesus died and went to the cross. He ascended and he was like, look, you guys need to wait because in a few days you're going to be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And then Jesus was explaining to them, unless you receive this, you won't receive my power. And when you receive this power, it's going to make you a witness. So they're all together. There's about 120 of them. They're in this upper room just praying. You know, I can imagine most of them are scared because the people were being crucified. Jesus was just killed. So now they're left thinking, okay, this dude just went up to heaven and he left us holding the ball. But he says we're going to receive this power. You know, when Jesus was around, he spoke with power. He had authority. You know, Jesus wasn't afraid to go to the cross and to die. You know, but we're weak people. You know, a lot of us, we ran away from Christ when he got crucified. So what are we going to do? So they're all together and they're praying. And then out of nowhere, man, this mighty rushing wind sweeps through the place. Come on, I wish you could have seen it. You know, you ever see the Tasmanian devil, how he just... and you just see like a tornado going everywhere. This is kind of what happened. The Holy Spirit burst on the scene. Let me tell you, everybody noticed. And then out of nowhere, they see these tongues of fire dancing on everybody's head. Come on, somebody. I didn't see nothing like that, even with LSD. Come on, somebody. God is... He does these great and powerful things. So just imagine, they're up there praying, just like us. Imagine where you're praying right now, and all this crazy stuff starts to happen. You know, and they were in Jerusalem at the time. This was right after the Passover. There were so many people there from all these different lands, and a lot of them spoke different languages. And the apostles, man, they start speaking in these languages that they couldn't have known. And if you'll study the scripture, you'll know that most of these men, they weren't educated. The only thing they knew how to do was catch some fish. So they're there, and all of a sudden, they're saying stuff in these languages about Jesus that they could not know. And all these people are saying, well, aren't these some Galileans? How do they know our own native land's language? You know, so everybody's catching on, like, man, there's something going on here. What's going on with these guys? Even one guy told Peter, man, are you drunk? Peter's like, man, it's only but like 9 in the morning. I can't be drunk. Because back in the day, man, they didn't have like moonshine, they didn't have beer, they didn't have all the stuff we have today. What they had was wine, and their wine was so dulled down that it was like grape juice with a splash of alcohol. So if you were to get drunk off of this wine, you'd have to be drinking it for quite some time. You know, it was very weak compared to the modern day wine that you would think of. So Peter's like, man, I can't be drunk, it's only blah, blah, blah in the morning. Can anybody be baptized in the Holy Spirit? It's a good question, because we're talking about the 120 people that were following Jesus. The people that Jesus himself on earth promised, hey, you're going to receive this. So can anybody receive it? That's my next question. Acts 10, 44 to 46, and this is when the Gentiles received the Holy Spirit. Even as Peter was saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who were listening to the message. The Jewish believers who came with Peter were amazed that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles too, for they heard them speaking in other tongues and praising God. Now, if you don't know anything about the Gentiles, if you were a Jewish believer back in the day, if you were to even go into a home of a Gentile person, you would be defiled. They were considered unclean. You know, so basically, if anybody in this place is not of 100% Jewish descent, guess what? You're a Gentile. You know, and the things we ate, you know, the Jewish people, they couldn't have pig, couldn't have bacon and pork. Come on, somebody, I'm happy to be a Gentile. But they were speaking this, and the Holy Spirit fell on even the people that the Jewish people were trained were unclean. They weren't worthy of God. So then God was like, man, I'm no respecter of persons. Thank you, Charlie. God's like, I'm no respecter of persons, because even these people that you've been taught to think that they will defile you, now I'm going to pour my spirit out on them, and they're going to speak in these other tongues, and they're going to prophesy, and they're going to be used powerfully of God. Come on. So this is what Peter started to realize. Man, anybody can receive this gift. God can use anybody. If he's using these Gentiles... Let me tell you, there's a story in the Bible where a Gentile woman came up to Jesus, and she was asking for some food. And he was like, man, I can't give this to you. You're a Gentile. And she was like, well, even the dogs get the food that falls off the table. Even they get the scraps. So what she was telling Jesus is, look, I know that you guys are Jewish, and I know in your society we're basically dogs. God's embracing the dog factor. He's saying, you know what? You're every bit as good as these religious folks. You're every bit as good as these people say you should be. So I'm going to pour out my spirit on you, and you're going to receive this gift too. There has to be a method to this. It can't just be a spontaneous act. Because as of right now, all I've been talking about is they were doing something. The Holy Spirit dropped. You know, it just spontaneously happened. There was no rhyme or reason behind it. So there has to be some kind of method, because God's not a God of chaos. God has a way and a purpose for everything to happen. So this can't just be a spontaneous act. Acts 19:6. Then when Paul laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in other tongues and prophesied. So this is how the church then began to bring about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you, if you're saved, if you've received this baptism of the Holy Spirit, that means you have the power of God in you. So what Paul would do is he would walk up, he would lay hands on people, and they would receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you, this is something that still goes on today. There's several of us in the room that have been filled with the Holy Spirit, that have received this gift. And because of that, they are now able to go ahead and impart that over to you as well. Will this just make me a better witness for Christ? Come on, somebody. You probably don't even want a witness for Christ. Is that all this is? Is it just going to make you a little more bold to talk about Jesus when you're out and about? I'm pretty sure God has a little bit more in store for us than just chatterboxing, amen? 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 7 through 11. A spiritual gift is given to each of us so that we can help each other. To one person, the Spirit gives the ability to give wise advice. To another, the same Spirit gives a message of special knowledge. The same Spirit gives great faith to another, and to someone else, one Spirit gives the gift of healing. He gives one person the power to perform miracles, and another the ability to prophesy. He gives someone else the ability to discern whether a message is from the Spirit of God or from another spirit. Still, another person is given the ability to speak in unknown languages, while another is given the ability to interpret what is being said. It is the one and only Spirit who distributes all these gifts. He alone decides which gift each person should have. So you're not just getting the ability to be a witness, but what the Word of God says, which is true, it's accurate, it is breathed from the very breath of God. It says that each person that receives this gets a spiritual gift. Come on, somebody, and if you see your pastor, sometimes you get a few. Come on. All kidding aside, though, but everybody gets at least one. When you receive this baptism of the Holy Spirit, some people receive the ability to heal the sick. You know, I know a lot of times I've talked about Johannes Almritzer in here. Man, this guy does festivals where they see hundreds of thousands of people saved and set free. Man, I've never seen miracles like I have whenever I've gone over to Africa with them. Man, I prayed for a lady, and I swear to you, a tumor shrunk into her head. You know, this is the God we serve. He gives you the ability to do this. And it's not because you get a special gift, but the same Holy Spirit distributes all gifts. You know, some people, they might have the ability to step up here. And like, I know like about a month and a half ago, Ashley stood up here and she gave a prophetic word. And it touched so many people just in this room. That's not because Ashley's special. It's because she has a special God living within her that's given her this gift that she's able to step out and prophesy. She also has a gifting where she's able to discern spirits. You know, a lot of times when we're struggling with things, whether it's drugs, pornography, depression, there's a spirit that basically manifests those things in your life. God's given her the ability to be like, this person has a spirit of fear. And that's so important because when you're trying to deliver somebody, you need to know what to pray against. God's given her that ability. So there's all these gifts that God will give you when you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It's not just to be a witness. Amen that you get to be a witness. Because without witnesses, none of us would be here. Unless somebody knocked me on my thick head and said, hey, let me tell you about Jesus and what he's done, I wouldn't be here. That means this place wouldn't be here. So praise God, he gives you the ability to be a witness, but he gives you so much more than that. He gives you a gift that's going to be perfect for you. It's almost like you were made to fulfill this purpose. But until you plug into the power, let me tell you, the vacuum cleaner won't turn on. That ground's going to stay dirty because you haven't received the power. So what I want to do today is I want to encourage you guys. You know, our leadership team, we've received this power That's the only reason that people like us get to serve Jesus, because it's his power, not our ability. Come on, somebody. How many know that when you serve Jesus, it's not about your ability? Man, you could suck at everything on planet Earth, because it's not about your ability, it's about your availability. And when you're available, God will give you the skill set you need to do his work. So let me tell you, it's about him, it's not about us. I'm not standing up here because I like to flap my gums. I'm alive. Part of that, I do like to flap my gums. Come on, somebody. But I'm standing up here because Jesus did something great in my life, and I want to share it with you, because I believe I was in a place that most of you either are or have been at some point, and I felt like the guy that can't do nothing. I was always that guy in the back of the very last pew, my arms crossed. I didn't want to be there. I felt like God was disappointed in me and that I would never be useful for anything that would make a difference in this world. So if you've ever felt that way, guess what? You're in good company. But let me tell you, Jesus, he used that guy. He's using that guy to give you this message right now. So what I want to do is I want to impart this to you today. God can use you. And let me tell you, a lot of you probably have more skills than I do. Come on, somebody. God will take you above and beyond anywhere he's taken me. He's no respecter of persons. You know, when Brian Bolt told me that, I went to his church, you know, his story is he was a heroin addict. He was shot in the head. I was like, man, is that bullet still bouncing around in there? You're telling me God's going to do something incredible through my life. Do you not know I've screwed up every opportunity I've ever gotten? The one thing I was good at was wrestling, and I broke my back, so I can't even do that now. Let me tell you, I was sitting in a cubicle for 40, 50 hours a week, hating life, man. Like, I hated my job. I had people that called up and yelled at me. Because of that, I went home and I yelled at her. Because I needed to pay it forward. I got yelled at for 40 hours a week, so I went home and I gave her a good 40 hours. But he's telling me God can do this incredible thing in you. You just have to be open to it. You have to believe by faith that God can do it. You're keeping God in this tiny little box. You know, for about the first year I was saved, I wouldn't even pray for God to heal my back, because I had him in this box. I thought, you know what? I probably got one good prayer in me. So I'm going to keep this in my back pocket, because God forbid, maybe one day I'm going to be facing cancer. And here I am thinking the person that created this entire place we call the world, the entire galaxy, with just a single breath, couldn't heal a back and cancer. Come on, somebody, you need to take God out of that box. You need to believe that God can take people just like you and do incredible things. You know, that's the only reason I'm here, because let me tell you, the Bible says God will take the foolish things in the world and use it to confound the wise. I believed Pastor Brian because I looked at him and I said, this guy's more screwed up than I am. But God uses him. You know, next month we're going to be celebrating 100 churches that this man has planted. Come on, somebody. The guy's more screwed up than I am. 100 churches. What can he do through you? Come on. Some of us might have good background. Some of us might have, you know, a pedigree. Come on. If you have a pedigree, help a brother out. Jesus wants to use you. We need to plug into the power. So normally I'll do a takeaway right now, but today, man, what I want to do is I'm going to give you an invitation to receive this baptism of the Holy Spirit here in a minute. But first, I don't want you to walk into it blind. Let me give you some of the benefits that come from this. Number one, it'll deepen your personal relationship with God. I don't know about you, but when I got this revelation that God was real and that he actually cared for me, I wanted to know him better. You know what I mean? I didn't want to just keep this God in the box and then go to him one day when cancer strikes. You know, a lot of my life, I thought, you know, I like doing me. You know, I understand God's there and he's good, but whenever I get older, I'll turn to God. That way I can, you know, squeak into heaven. But then I met him. And let me tell you, there's no one like Jesus. Oh, man, he's the sweetest presence you'll ever meet. So I met Jesus, and I just wanted more. You know, that Holy Spirit became like catnip. I had to have more Holy Spirit. It's going to deepen your relationship with God. Second thing it's going to do is give you a hunger for God's Word, and it's going to give you better understanding for it. You know, whenever I got saved, 5 days later, there was this guy named Toasty. He's been here a couple times. He's a missionary over in China. Man, this dude is so on fire for Jesus. I'm just sitting there, man. I'm here. I'm on board with Jesus, but I kind of want to keep Jesus over here, and I can just chill here and do me while I try to do him a little bit. He came up to me, and he goes, all right, here's what we're going to do. I'm thinking, you haven't even introduced yourself to me. Here's what we're going to do. And, man, this dude was lanky. He was all about Jesus. You know, he had this big cross on him, and I'm like, all right, man, I'm just going to do what you say so you get away from me. I mean, honestly, that's how I felt. He goes, we're going to baptize you in the Holy Spirit. And I was like, what the heck is the Holy Spirit? You know, I grew up with the sign of the cross, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. So, what are you going to do, make a cross on me, bro? Like, what's crack-a-lack in here? But he goes, we're going to baptize you in the Holy Spirit. He started to explain these scriptures to me. And I'm thinking, man, I ain't even read the Bible. You're telling me all these things. Do you want me to do what? He's like, no, come on, we're going to speak together. What? You know, you can pray for me, what are you doing? He goes, blah, 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 blah. And I'm looking at him like, this dude just had a stroke. What is going on? And he goes, no, you repeat it. So just to give him away, I'm like, blah, 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 and I'm trying to like mimic what he's saying. He goes, no. You don't say what I say, you say what God says. What are you talking about, bro? So he goes, no, just try. So finally I'm like, what do I have to lose? You know what I mean? I got this weirdo on my shoulder. I didn't even ask him to come. He just basically came at me like a pit bull on a pork chop. So if a pit bull is going to leave the pork chop alone, he's going to get the meat. So I was like, all right, God, let me forfeit my meat. So I just started shouting, and then like stuff's coming out. I'm like, where the heck did that come from? You know what I mean? And like I start to speak in this other language I never heard before in my life, and it was like the weirdest thing. He goes, all right, you've just received the Holy Spirit. And I was like, no way. That's pretty cool. I've been doing this thing for about 5 days now. I got the Holy Spirit already. Come on. I felt like I got a cheat code to Jesus. It was incredible. And he goes, here's what I want you to do. When you're driving to work in the morning, how long does it take you to get there? I said, maybe 8 minutes, you know, give or take with traffic. And he goes, well, here's what I want you to do. Take 5 of those 8 minutes and just practice this. And I was like, are you serious? Did you want me to do this in my car? And he's like, yeah. And here's what I want you to do. If you don't notice God speaking to you or doing anything different in a week, then quit. So I said, that's all I got to do. These 5 days when I'm driving to work, on my way. And if God doesn't do something, quit. He said, yeah, that's all I want you to do. So then I start doing this as I'm going to work. And man, it was like God like just showed up in my car. And I'm thinking, man, this is incredible. I thought I had to go to church to experience God in this way. You know, I'm driving down the road. I got my ACD blaring. I'm like, highway to hell. And out of nowhere, I feel Jesus next to me. Come on, somebody. The highway to hell turned into the highway to heaven. I was on the Jesus Express, and it was incredible. So this is what I want you to realize. Even though it's something that seems weird, it's something they do in the Bible. And the reason they do it in the Bible is because it's a very important part of your Christian walk. And God started to give me this hunger for his word. You know, from that day when Toasty did that with me, in 2 months, I read the entire Bible, cover to cover. Really, the Bible in half, because I started in the New Testament, read through that, went back to the Old Testament, and I was like, ugh, I want the New Testament again. So I read that again. In 2 months, every break of work, I was reading my Bible. People walked by like, I didn't know you were religious. I said, I'm not. This is awesome. Guess what Jesus just did? He just walked on some water. My third benefit is it gives you the anointing. Come on, somebody. When you see Pastor James hold the microphone, there's a clear anointing on his life. You know, did you ever hear somebody say, you know, one of the old timers like Graham, she'll say, man, what was that lady who used to be out of Pastor Brian's building? Catherine Coleman.
Yeah.
Oh, man, when Catherine
Coleman was here, you should have seen the anointing she brought. When Benny Hinn came, he went like this, and like half the crowd fell over. Because there's an anointing on their life. Let me tell you how they got that anointing. They received the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit brought upon that anointing. So if you've ever looked, I know there's a lot of pastors that I've kind of like looked at, and man, I would love to get this part of their game. I'd love to have that part of their game. You're attracted to their anointing. And how you receive your own anointing is letting the Holy Spirit bring that out of you. The next benefit is it'll improve your prayer life with the Lord. So let me tell you, even though bee-boo-bop doesn't sound like much, sometimes you get to a point where you're so beat down, you don't even know what to pray. So what the Bible says is when you do that, and you speak in your prayer language, because when you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you're going to get a special prayer language that's just between you and God. So when you pray that way, the Holy Spirit prays through you. So sometimes you might not understand what you're praying for. Guess what? God knows what you need to pray for, and He'll pray through you. The fifth point is sanctification. Lord knows I'm still working on this one. What sanctification is it's a process of taking you from being broken and beat up to making you more like Jesus. It's called a sanctification process. And how many knows it is a process? So I'm not saying you come up here, you receive Jesus, you walk out of here, and you have no problems. It's a process. Every single day, as you let the Holy Spirit work through you, you're going to become a little bit more like Jesus. And after a while, people are going to look at you like, holy heck, what happened to him? It's sanctification. As you can tell by some of the messages you've heard, I'm still working on my sanctification, but it's a process. You know, the Bible says that he who started this good work in you will continue it until the day of Christ Jesus. So until Jesus comes back, this process isn't over. But let me tell you, every day you can get a little bit closer. The next point is number six, the fruits of the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you, this is patience, joy, peace, self-control. Who doesn't need more of that in their lives? So let me tell you, if you don't have the fruits of the Holy Spirit in your life, you need to get the Holy Spirit in your life. You know, that's like going to Giant Eagle, wanting to get some fruits and skipping produce. You can't get the fruits of the Holy Spirit without having the Holy Spirit. Come on. Number seven benefit is the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Come on, you can't step out there and heal the sick. You can't speak in another language. You can't prophesy unless you receive the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Number eight is communication from God. Let me tell you, whenever I'm in the shower, this is where I get most of my messages. I'm just in the shower praying to God. Most of the time I'll have my Pandora on and I'll just be speaking in my prayer language, just me and God. And out of nowhere, I'll go, you should preach about the Holy Spirit. I'll go, what? Jesus said, well. And then I'll start praying about it, like, are you sure about this guy? How do you want me to do this? And he'll be like, well, let's see, the first week, you should tell them that I'm a person. And let me give you some examples as to how I am a person. Because no one can see the Holy Spirit. I said, okay, I can do that, God. What about the second week, Lord? Well, you should explain to them the work that I do. And how they can be a part of it, how like we're co-destined to be like tag team partners, me and them. Because we have a job to do, and I can't do mine unless they plug into their part. That's really good, God. But there's got to be a good ending to this. What am I going to do? He goes, I saved the best for last. You're going to teach them about my power. You're going to tell them the truth that they might not have ever heard. And then at the end, you're going to give them the opportunity to do the same thing that I've done through you. Number nine is you begin to see things more clearly. So let me tell you, sometimes when you're a mess, your vision gets kind of cruddy. But when the Holy Spirit comes in, He starts cleaning up your mess, you can see a lot more clearly. That's like if you go mudding, your windshield's going to get dirty. The Holy Spirit wants to do that windshield wiper. To get all that crud out so that you can see God more clearly, you can see yourself more clearly, you can see your family and those around you. Because let me tell you, God wants to open your eyes. He wants you to see things the way He sees things. And that starts with allowing yourself to be open to the Holy Spirit. And then my last point is, number 10, you will become more compassionate. Come on, wouldn't you like to live in a nicer world where people are nicer to each other? The Holy Spirit makes you more compassionate. So let me tell you, before I received the Holy Spirit, I don't really care if you heard this message. But let me tell you, it's going to hurt my heart if you don't receive it. Because the Holy Spirit has made you compassionate. Because God loves you so much. And he's letting me taste that just a little bit as I prepare these messages. Because he wants you to get this. That if you allow the Holy Spirit to come into your life, you could be somebody that doesn't like people. Let me tell you, I wasn't a fan. I was not a fan of people. You know, I always had my natural charisma from wrestling, but as far as people, I could have done without them. The Holy Spirit broke my heart for what breaks Jesus' heart, and that is his people. So the Holy Spirit will make you more compassionate. So what I want to do is we're going to open up the altars, and our prayer team's going to come up here. So if our prayer team can come up right now, I'm also going to ask Pastor Greg to come up, and he's going to share a quick story. And real quick before he does that, Ashley's going to share a word. Don't you just love when the Holy Spirit manifests himself? God gets so excited. He's like, all right, Holy Spirit, it's your turn. Because you know what I'm doing through this message? I'm taking the power and the authority out of my hands, and I'm putting it in God's hands. And when you'll do that, when you'll give God the authority to operate his church any way he sees fit, let me tell you, he shows up and he does things. So just like I was telling you about that word from the Lord, she just got one. Come on, share that.
So this morning when I woke up, I didn't feel anything. And then as they were practicing this morning before anybody got here, I kept hearing Matthew. And then during worship, the Lord showed me a vision of myself. Great is the night pretty much he changed my life when I was at the altar and I had just cut myself and tried to kill myself. And the Lord showed me that during worship. And I was like, all right, Lord. I feel like God keeps bringing me back to that just so I remember what he has done in my life, because I tend to forget. I tend to get comfortable. And if you're comfortable, that's not a good place to be in the Lord. And then I really feel like the Lord said, Matthew, again. And I was looking at it. And I don't know who this is for. I don't know what you're going through, but I believe that the Lord wants to impact your heart today and let you know that he hasn't left you. But it's Matthew 11:28, and it says, then Jesus said, come to me, all who are weak and weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light. I really feel like the Lord is really speaking to somebody who is weary in this place today. And I don't know who you are, and I feel like you're ready to give up. And I feel like you don't think the Lord is with you, that he has left you. But he's confirming today that he's with you and he loves you. So I believe that being baptized in the Holy Spirit would be an awesome step for you to take today. But so I just pray that God, you would take whatever message you have spoken through Anthony today, and I just pray that you have met somebody here today, God, that needed this word from you, God. God, I pray that we would all, in our weariness, raise our hands and come to you and just be filled with your Holy Spirit, knowing that you are who you say you are, that you are a God that loves us, that you are a God that has not forgotten about us, that you are a God who makes all things new, that you are a God who is perfect in everything that you do, just like we sang today, God. God, I pray that we would not try to understand why you do things in our life that break us down, but I pray, God, we would just come to you, Father. We would just come to you, Abba, knowing that you have a perfect plan in our life. God, I just pray that you would, just like in Acts, because you're the same today as you were in Acts, I pray that this place would be filled with your Holy Spirit and people just would begin to shout in joy in tongues, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray.
So I'm going to let Pastor Greg share. As soon as he's finished, really what I want you to do, if you've never experienced the baptism of the Holy Spirit, every single person up here, myself, Ashley, Lisa, we've all experienced the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and it's because of that that we're here today. So if you haven't experienced that, I really strongly encourage you to come up here and pray with these people, because you will receive it in the name of Jesus. And let me tell you, not only have we received it, we've been the conduit that has allowed other people to receive it over the years as well. So this isn't something that's just for the early church. This is for you. And like I was saying, try it. God doesn't show up in a week. Don't do it anymore. I mean, I ain't going to come to your house and force you. But I'm giving you an opportunity to plug into God's power, to be more than a lump on a log, but to be impactful for God's kingdom. Because let me tell you, when you are impactful for God's kingdom, you have an eternal purpose, and your life will have meant something. Come on.
Man, I don't want to continue to talk about things. I just like to, why don't you just start coming up now, and I'll talk while you come up. Are you coming up? Please don't rush. No, please. One of the things I wanted to tell, seriously, I do invite you to come forward. Pretend you're coming for communion. There's a message in that. What I wanted to tell you is this. A lot of times, a lot of our illustrations go about hearts. When we talk about preaching, we talk about things like that. But some of the two people that came to my mind, even this pastor, Anthony, was sharing. Wasn't that an awesome? Isn't that an awesome message? Whatever happens today, that's just an awesome. Amen. Awesome message. I thought of Gene Brown. Man was baptized in the Holy Spirit years ago. Never left working in mills. Worked as a machinist. And he had just this gentle presence, but he had this power when he talked to people. He prayed in the Spirit all the time. We talked about praying in tongues. It's not just about getting tongues. It's just a lot of what Pastor was saying. It's just, well, everything Pastor was saying. But it enables you to touch lives just simply by being, I like the word, that conduit, but being that presence of Jesus, even in a more powerful way. And a lady came to mind years ago. I don't want to say this like just a housewife. I don't mean it that way at all. But that's what she did. That was her life. And she walked through a Piggly Wiggly store once. That's down in Texas, by the way. And she walks through there. She said she thought God wanted her to stop because maybe there was a special on beans, you know. But she walked through because she could hear the Spirit of God, and there was a lady having a stroke at one of the, or something was happening to her on the sides of the grocery store. And she said, she goes, "Ma'am, can I help you?" And the lady couldn't even respond. And so she said, "I just quietly began to pray in the Spirit for her." She didn't jump up on the celery and start screaming in tongues. She quietly prayed in the Spirit. You know, it doesn't make you crazy. It makes you full of power. Okay? And she prayed for that lady. And the lady just comes to, and she goes, "I'm better now. Thank you." And I don't know if she ever knew that lady or not. You know, but I have to admit, as a young Christian, I started hanging around Piggly Wiggly just to see if something would happen. I can't remember anything, except I probably made security nervous, you know. But I want to invite you up. Please come up. You know, you have this line of people. I don't know if that's supposed to be, but we intimidate. That's not what it's supposed to be. This is family. And this is the kind of church this is. And you say, well, will there be other invitations? Yes, there will be other invitations. But this, God didn't speak these messages to your pastor so we can think about it in 2 or 3 years. He spoke so we can respond now. So I just invite you to come up. And if you've already been baptized in the Holy Spirit and you speak in tongues, you know, sometimes at the tongue part, it lacks fluency. I believe the tongues, by the way, is like a common gift that every believer is eligible to receive. Others you can see spread out here and there. But that is something that every mom needs to be able to pray for their kids. Every mom, no matter how old their kids get. And it's just so practical. But one more time, I invite you to come up. I'll let Pastor. Pastor said he won't come and hunt you down, but I might. No, we'd like you.
No, I'm just want to share. I mean, I understand the whole thing about this. My thing before I received the Holy Spirit, my thing was I didn't want to be forced to do anything. And I remember on the north side, I remember Pastor Justin was up there, and he like, everybody's doing the Holy Spirit thing, and I remember he was saying, so he came over to me like, come on, brother. Come on, he always called me brother. He's like, come on, brother, you can do it. And he kept doing it and doing it. And I remember I literally screamed back at him. I'm like, I can't. And, like, and he just walked away. I guess he was kind of, you know. And so one day we're sitting down, we're having a men's meeting, and I don't know, you met Pastor Angela. Whenever it was time for a revival, they called Pastor Angela because this man carries the Holy Spirit with him. So one day he would just sit down and he would just preach it. And the Holy Spirit came upon me and I started speaking in tongues because I was one of those people who thought it was weird. I'd sit in the city reach like, these dudes are crazy, all this other stuff. And it came. And so what I realized was, for me, it couldn't be forced. But here's what I really want to share with God laid on my heart is, we do this every week, and I know all of you now, and that nobody ever gets up. And here's what I just want to share with you. I'm not trying to force you to do anything. Here's what I'm trying to say is, because I know a lot of you, I know there's a lot of things in your life you want God to change in your life or to move in your life. You'd be lying if you said you did. You can't do it without the Holy Spirit. Nothing you want in life you cannot do without the Holy Spirit. I'm letting you know that right now. So what is interesting is Pastor Anthony, God has laid this on his heart, because one thing I told Pastor Anthony months and months and months ago, I said, one thing I think that we're lacking, I don't mean this in any disrespect or anything, a lot of people are missing the Holy Spirit. They love the worship, they love God. I'm not saying nobody here loves God or nothing, but what I'm trying to understand is maybe because you don't understand the Holy Spirit. So what God has done now is explain the Holy Spirit to you. You can't do anything without the Holy Spirit. You want your relationship fixed, you want your body fixed, you want things in your life, you want things to change in your life. You need the Holy Spirit to do it. And so what I'm trying to say is, what they used to do in other churches was, you had to get up, and if you ever wanted to receive salvation, you couldn't even sit down and receive salvation. You would have to get up and walk down to receive salvation. And the hardest thing, it took me a year to receive salvation, because it took me a whole year to get out of that seat. But there's a part in the Bible, and I've shared this with y'all in one of my sermons. There's a part where Jesus showed up with the man on the mat who had been landing for 40-something, 30-something years. Jesus asked him, do you want to be healed? He said, yes. Jesus said, get up. Jesus didn't help him up. He didn't give him instructions. Jesus said, you want to be healed, get up. If you understand, the dude had laid there for 30-something years. The moment he got up, he was healed. He couldn't have got up if he wasn't healed. He had to just believe that when Jesus says for me to get up, that's what's going to be my help. I believe for some of you, what you're praying for God to change in your life isn't going to be when you see it change. It's going to be when you get up. It's going to be when you get up out of that seat and say, you know what? I'm going to put all my fear to the side. I'm going to put everything else to the side. I'm going to get up. And the healing's going to be in you getting up, not in what you're waiting for to see in somebody or something that you change. You understand what I'm saying? The healing's in getting up. It's the faith. So I'm just sharing that with you to understand. I understand how it feels. You're like, I don't want to get up. I want to go down. I don't want to. But I'm trying to tell you right now, I believe for everybody in here, the healing begins. Whatever you need begins when you get out of that seat and say, you know what, God, I'm not going to stand here stubborn. Jesus said, do you want to be healed? You say yes, and his answer will be, get up. And that's it. Simple message. Get up. What up? God, I need this. Get up. So I'm just sharing that with you so you understand this. We all need God. We all need healing, and we all need God to do something in our lives. And the only answer going to be is to get up. I'm just telling you right now, don't be surprised. All Jesus says is get up. So.